on a Friday evening. I'm introducing Claire Ashley, who is an associate professor of contemporary practices at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. Her site-specific inflatable sculptures straddle the mediums of painting, sculpture, installation, and performance. Through these objects, she explores themes of labor, ritual, endurance, humor, and the body. Her recent exhibitions include Division of Labor at Glass Curtain Gallery, Distant Landscapes, Peep Dyed Crevice Hot Pink Ridge at Icebox Gallery in Philadelphia, Frizz Flop Squeeze Pop at the Chicago Cultural Center, Neo Yellow Piao Wow at the Bahamas Biennale. I know, Limes and Bricks Suck Pink You Tasteless Hunk, Terrain, an exterior exhibition space in Oak Park, Illinois, and My Crippled Friend at Columbus College of Art and Design. Please join me in welcoming Claire Ashley.
Hello, everybody. Oh, thank you. Hold on 1 second. I got to get my shit together. Okay, we did it. All right, so I'm trained as a painter. But I have spent 20 years trying to figure out my relationship to my relationship to painting, and I've never been satisfied with a flat surface. I've never been satisfied with a straight edge, and I've always sort of had a much more sort of physical, visceral relationship to material, and sort of be more interested in sculpture. Anyway, my work when I in the past sort of 10 to 15 years has really been transformed by having kids, and by thinking about I wrote this manifesto just in the last year because I'm sort of really interested in becoming more in control of the language or the way that my work is spoken about. And being more sort of aggressive and present and explicit about the fact that I am a mom, I am a maker, I am an intuitive person, I am stupid, I am in some sense an activist, and yet in other ways really an activist through the objects that I make. I am a body, I am frail, I am flaccid, I am maximal, right? And I really do feel like these words become a really important part of me framing my work in terms of a feminist stance, but also in relationship to being in control and sort of aggressive about making monumental work that is both soft and colorful and absurd and playful and comedic. Making painting I'm very serious about, but that it also is important that it is on a surface that is not painting, right? And again, thinking about humor and absurdity as a really important part of my relationship, my irreverence towards the history of painting and the history of sculpture. So in 2004, after having three kids in quick succession, I started transforming sort of my relationship to material into forms that were more about symbols for protection, for nurture, and for overprotection. And I was using on the left is a piece that used pink foam, insulation foam, to make a sort of a miniature architectural structure. And on the right is just a gouache on paper to make a sort of floppy ladder form that obviously both objects are sort of art versions and completely failures to actually function in any way, but they were part of my freaking out about being responsible for these three beings in the world that I was still a new thing to me. I was also stealing my kids' toys at that point, and then burying them in toothpicks. So I was really thinking about what is that, how do I kind of express, again, my angst and my relationship to being this responsible being for these creatures, and how am I both mothering them in terms of protecting them, but also smothering them and sort of bearing my own head under the sand. So these small pieces on the left, I made about 50 of those. But I also then started to think about larger scale sculpture and how the body then interacts or intervenes, and how sculpture becomes a prop for the body. So this is my first experiment with plastic, and it became more like a shower curtain, I think, as a little psycho in some ways, but it was sort of a first attempt at an inflatable, which failed as an inflatable, but was interesting in terms of how I considered it in relationship to performative prop. This is a collaborative piece. I should say at this point, collaboration for me and my practice over the years has been a really important way for me to work outside of my comfort zone, to really solve problems in somebody else's head. In such a way that then I can bring those sort of solutions to problems back into my own studio practice. So this piece was a collaboration with Mark Jeffrey and Judd Morrissey, who are two performance artists from Goat Island, and who I teach with Mark in Chicago. I made the sort of obnoxious plastic shoe-like car cover on the left for this performance piece that happened at sunrise and sunset each day. And then when I got the piece back from the performance, I actually sealed it up, and those two pieces on the right are the sealed up shoe on the bottom, and then I made a inflatable cube that had the a life-size version of my living room window on it. So this sort of literal idea of a mobile home that also mimics a bounce house for kids. I was also thinking about airbags that protect kids in terms of car activity. And I also like the idea that the shoe and the car do similar things with the body in terms of moving a body from A to B and sort of housing it in a shell of non-organic, necessarily, material. So the mobile home was sort of the first inflatable piece from 2007 that I felt like I had successfully kind of considered both painting and sculpture in sort of equivalent ways, and being able to sort of bring the content that I was interested in that point into the work directly. Another three-hour performance piece I did at the Chicago Cultural Center. This piece is called Fort, and I realized that I had built a giant hoop skirt, which I later realized, because of its grid pattern, was a sort of stereotypical kilt, basically. I come from Scotland, and I was like, oh my goodness, I've just built myself a giant stereotypical Scottish form of dress. But it became interesting to be, and then it was this foundation then for me to build a nest around myself using cardboard boxes. I used colors from my home, sort of oops paint and various paints that I had used in the house over the years to paint these cardboard boxes. So there was sort of a kid-like relationship to play and imagination that was happening in a live 3-hour performance piece. Another project that I worked on with Mark and Judd was, and this really sort of pushed my work into this, more directly into this idea of using inflatables as performative prop. They gave me the task of making two 16-foot tall sets of wings for performers to wear during their performance called The Procession. And these are stills from the Hyde Park Arts Center in 2011. So that forced me to solve the problem of attaching a fan to a backpack and sewing the inflatables into a backpack, which I had thought about before, but I had never been forced to solve that problem. The other interesting thing about this piece is that I was able to follow the dancers around the space in rehearsal and basically tape the floor behind them, basically. So I used their actions and their moves and their positions of their bodies in the space as a way to then create a sort of celestial map or constellation that marked their bodies on the floor. So I really liked using the space as a surface for painting in some ways. The problem with these pieces so far was that I really felt like tape was a very static way to include color and line on the shapes. And so over winter break between classes one year, I decided, what the fuck, I'm going to try and test these things out. And so I got some cans of spray paint and tried spray painting directly on the surface of the inflatables. And it was really a sort of an epiphany for me in terms of coming back full circle to starting as a painter and then trying out all these sort of ways to think about color and to think about paint and to think about surface sculpturally, to then come back full circle to get that painterly language back into the objects. So this piece is called Star Patrick, and I really make these pieces while looking at way too many cartoons and way too much SpongeBob, and really thinking about humor and now figuration. I mean, I never thought 20 years ago when I first started making work, 25 years ago, I should say, that I would end up making figurative sculpture, but here I am. And sort of the process of getting there has allowed me a much greater kind of complexity in terms of where I get source material from. And again, having kids is the only reason that I got to SpongeBob, right? And I got to thinking about figurative sculpture and painting. This is Clown on the left and Knees Up on the right. And again, sort of using cartoon imagery and sort of absurd form and figurative body extension with a sort of very serious engagement with abstraction and color. At this point in the practice, this is 2011, I think. Yeah, 2011. I really got interested in two things. I had been primarily working with objects and trying to figure out how the hell I paint on these sculptural objects. But at this point, I got really interested in the objects in relationship to space and the objects in relationship to the body. So the next sort of batch of work that I'll show you is sort of my sort of research around that. This is a show that was done at Sidecar in Hammond, Indiana, and it's a sort of an apartment space, so it's got that domestic scale to it, and I really loved that my sort of relationship to kids and domesticity gets sort of located and contextualized in a very particular way in this type of gallery space. But what I did was in the foreground here with the big V, wooden 2x4 V shape, I really tried to prevent the audience from entering the space. I forced them to bend under the 2x4 stick to get into the gallery space. I prevented them from entering the rear space a little bit by filling the back space with an object in the doorway. So I was really starting to try and think about how these things that can get so big so quickly without, very little money can really start to build and fill up space in a more dramatic way. Which led to this piece at Terrain, as Rosalind mentioned, I showed there a couple times, which is a really, Oak Park is a really liberal, arts and craftsy town, very, very tasteful. And so I was really interested in how my crazy, weird, abstract, figurative sort of hunk of meat kind of objects squeeze out of, and become this really obnoxious, tasteless, sort of aggressive thing in the space. And funny, too, but that's why I called it Tasteless Hunk, in that I wanted to play both with the idea of class and kind of education and sort of tastefulness, but also the explicitness of body part that not only links with hunks of meat necessarily, but hunks of body and a more very sexually sort of explicit way that you could potentially read the forms. I was also really interested in the body in relationship to performance. So you will see this. This is a test in my studio.
Dance.
I'll just, yeah, you get the drift. You get the drift. So for that piece, I mean, I was by myself in my studio. It was really important for me that I use some crass pop music. It was really important for me that the absurdity and the sort of playfulness of the shape be backed up by a sort of like... embarrassing kind of activity by me in the studio that I was willing to share then with people. And that sort of idea of play, literally embedding play in how people see the piece, got considered a little bit more directly in this show, where I had this single inflatable dancing object be accessible for people as they came to the opening. And I was sort of really interested in both how that sort of, that idea that as you look at somebody doing it, it seems quite playful, but actually the experience of being in, of trying to get in the object and being in the object is kind of a lot darker. It's very sweaty. It's really hard to get in there. It's hard to breathe as you're getting in there. It sort of like has this sort of birthing channel kind of feel to it. So it was like grotesque in some ways and yet playful in others. This is another piece that, so after doing a couple of single person dancing pieces, I started thinking that I wanted to have more of a camaraderie. So I went to making two person dancing pieces. Let's see if this will work. I don't know if it will. Nope. Anyway, what I did was I went from, I used a Bee Gees song, and I moved from I stretched it out and slowed it down at the beginning and really sped it up at the end. And I wanted the way that the activity of the dancers were interacting with it for it to be quite dark early on, and that the recognition of the song took a while in the viewer's head. I also did this piece, the idea of Tunis, in front of the Jim Dine sculptures at the Decordova Sculpture Park and Museum. Which was an exciting context shift and sort of direct sort of link to the idea that these forms come together at a certain point in the song or in the choreography and sort of smooch against one another. So I was really interested in that sort of idea, that playful and absurd relationship to Tunis and to Lerv in all its sort of crass hallmark possibilities. I'm going to keep going in terms of the interest of time, but I'm going to try and get out of here to show you this piece. 2 led to 12 for some reason. I'm not exactly sure why I went from 2 to 12. But I got the opportunity to do to be a visiting artist in the residency program in Acre. And I was really interested in the idea of landscape and the scale of the American landscape and the possibilities of the scale for these performative objects to exist in relationship to the body. I'm always sort of interested in challenging the status quo of any medium I'm working in. And so this piece became this really sort of ambitious sort of opportunity for me to take on a much larger object, and how do I move that much larger object? How many people do I need to move that? So let me see if I can get out of here and show you that. Sorry. It's coming, it's coming. Okay, so this is it.
Sorry, guys.
Oh, you're not seeing it.
Yep.
All right, hold on. Getting there. You see it now? So for me, again, the idea of the pastoral giant American landscape and this odd cow-like reference thing. I also wanted to use country music. Wouldn't it be as absurd? Okay, so you get the drift. It's on Vimeo if you want to watch it. But I tried to find a country song that didn't talk about religion, didn't talk about love, didn't talk about, spiritual, all of the classic country things, and just talked about having a good time. So the idea of absurdity and playfulness in a farm, sort of farmland context was really important to me, and that it kind of had that cow, weird caterpillar or cow, kind of odd animalistic reference was also important to me. Let's see where we're at. What's the next one? Oh yeah. So I wasn't satisfied with a piece that was 20 feet tall, but no, I had to go and kind of up the ante and make a piece on the left that was 35 feet tall. And I in my show at the Chicago Cultural Center, which I'll show you in a sec, I got the opportunity to perform in Daly Plaza next to the Picasso sculpture. And I really was interested in how I really wanted to have a meeting of the minds. I want to be buds with Picasso in some ways, right? But I was interested in, okay, me as a woman. So I was interested in that male-female. I was interested in monumentality, but in terms of soft form, painted surface, as opposed to hard form, monochromatic material, and not a surface painted on there. I was interested in absurdity and seriousness, and sort of all the contrasts of those two events, and sort of ephemerality and permanence, right? But on the left is what people see, the dancers on the inside. So how people sort of, they can see each other when they're in these forms, but they can't see outside of the piece. And so that was part of my sort of building of the sort of playfulness of the pieces, that I wanted, when you're in the piece individually for the one or the two person pieces, you can't see shit outside of the form. And so the only way you find your partner is to call them, right? Or is to, within the choreography that we rehearse outside of the project, the piece, is to then know that you're going to find each other at a certain point. But within the 12 person, I really liked the community that was happening, and the hilarity and the absurdity and the whooping and the giggling that you could hear as a viewer outside of the piece as it was being performed. Like, you got a sense of that when you listen to the field, the acre piece. Anyway, so that was part of my thinking in terms of going to so many people, is that then there's a camaraderie inside the form as well as something ridiculous outside the form. But after that, I was tired, I sort of decided I was showing in this tiny little space that was embedded in its name, the Bahamas Biennial. Space in Milwaukee was the idea of the critique of the Biennale, right? And so I was really interested in a 10-foot by 10-foot space and how I was going to respond to that, but with something that I hadn't done before. So I was using, for this piece, I was really thinking about drawing in space. I was thinking about stuffed smaller forms as still having a relationship to stuffed animals or toys or pillows or mattresses. And so there's still playfulness and sort of odd, wonky compositional absurdity going on, but that it's... that it is is a lighter kind of interruption in the space, I guess. I should also say at this point, I forgot to say earlier, but a lot, so much of the impetus of my work is to think about ecstatic experience, right? So it's either the visual pleasure principle, so the idea of outrageously obnoxious color, or it's the ecstatic sort of dancing physical experience that is required in order to enter these things and dance in these things and activate these things. So those two things sort of really drive my work most of the time. So the piece, this is stills from the Cultural Center show that I mentioned earlier. On the left is a piece called Bo Wo Zo. And I was really thinking about Bozo the Clown. I was thinking about beauty. I was thinking about wow factors. And I was thinking about sort of, again, absurd kind of figurative form that also is very seriously sort of interested in abstraction. Also, the Cultural Center at that point, they've just fixed up the Cultural Center, and I missed that fix up whatsoever, but they've now put wooden floors in. But at the time, they had all sorts of holes all around the space in the walls. I'm like, what? My sort of solution was just to stick some of these little stuffy things that I make in directly into the walls. So that compositionally sort of made my decisions for me in so many ways, and actually used the space in a very specific way that would never have happened without the holes being there first. This is called Another Tasteless Hunk. So it's a second piece in response to the Limes and Bricks You Tasteless Hunk piece at the Terrain Show. And actually that piece I pushed in the back of the, behind this other piece to sort of make a landscape of sorts and to think about mountains and icebergs and sort of bodies piled together. And I think partly it might have been the project at Acre, the dancing piece that was out in the literal landscape that started me thinking about stacking these things together and thinking about them less as individual objects and thinking about them more as components within a larger field of activity. So this piece, this is called the Distant Landscapes installation, Peep Dyed Crevice, Hot Pink Ridge, at Icebox Gallery in Philadelphia. And it was an old icebox, so it was literally like 100 feet long by 50 feet wide by 30 feet tall. And I arrived the day of install in my minivan, both a perfect union of art and family, in my minivan with all my shit, all my pieces, and they were really freaking out that I wouldn't have enough work. So they were really happy that I was one of the few artists that were able to fill their space substantially to make it feel different, to make it feel cozier or smaller somehow. So that's the My Little Pony piece that I performed at the Daily Plaza in the background. And then all of the rest of them are sort of stacked in relationship to one another. Another installation shot of that. And I like, for these pieces, it becomes really important for me that I'm painting in the round, right? That so that when I install them, I can put them in 5 different shows and have them look different each time. And that the beauty of sculptural painting is that you really get to flip things around and look at the piece differently each time. So I get bored really quickly. And so I like to be able to sort of invent and imagine and play each time I install work. This piece was the one at Columbus College of Art and Design that actually Emily's husband Patrick curated me into, so thank you very much. And I what I wanted to have happen with this piece is that I've been thinking about sort of limbless beings or hunks of meat and sort of body and yet not body at the same time, or animal or human paired together. And what I wanted to have happen with this show is that it got jammed and locked and held, pinned in the space in some ways. And people at the opening were great in that they said they felt very empathetic towards the object. They felt for it. They knew it. They had nowhere to go, right? Because it was permanently there. But you just actually unplug it, and then it falls down. But this piece is called Limp Punk Love Junk. And again, the sort of language of my titling of this work, it becomes really important for me to have the words, the way that I'm butting words up against one another to make a new form, a new word, have a relationship to the form, to the color, to the object itself, so that I am inventing the titles as I go. And I basically do a scribbling in my sketchbook for a couple days, butting different words up against one another to find something that gives a little bit more meaning to the object and sort of usually explicitness to the object that isn't there maybe without it. More landscape installation. This was at the Chicago Artists Coalition, and where I lifted the inflated objects off the floor to become more like clouds or floating serpents, and painted the floor of the space to bring the eye down. So, but there was nothing actually sitting on the floor in the space. It was very sort of airy, open, reversed kind of way to create an installation. I was also really interested in this installation because I knew it was going to be used for the Chicago Artists Coalition benefit. And so I was interested in trying out a nighttime state that I hadn't really ever... at least I tried out in early work in graduate school, but I hadn't really tried it out since. And because I use fluorescent paint on the pieces, they naturally fluoresce when you put black light on them. So I was really interested in these kind of animalistic, snake-like, or Nessie, Loch Ness monster, right? Beings coming alive at night and actually existing in a party space. So for me, not just talking about ecstatic dancing experience, but having the work exist within that kind of an atmosphere, that club kind of atmosphere. These are kind of small, but two shots from a larger installation I did for the Looking Glass Theater in Chicago, which was also their benefit. But again, this idea of a party atmosphere, or the idea of an event as opposed to a show. A lot of my work is I'm really interested in sort of how one creates work that is democratic. Obviously, we are all within the womb of art making world and conversation and language, and we all know what each other are talking about pretty much. But I am interested in how the work exists or is responded to by the general public as well. I'm really interested in how people access work on different levels, and that I want the work to be doing the talking rather than me needing to be next to the work telling people how to respond, right? So the show at the Cultural Center was a really great space for me to show in because it's not a purely art space, right? It's a free cultural institution in Chicago. They have 50,000 people walking through the building on a monthly basis. So it's a very different public that sees your work there as opposed to the Museum of Contemporary Art in Chicago or the Art Institute of Chicago. So I'm really interested in how that, how the color allows entry points, how the absurdity of the forms allow entry points, how the playfulness of and the relationship to bounce houses allows entry points into the work that people don't necessarily feel like they can get from sort of maybe more intellectually sort of based work in a museum setting, right? So that is a big part of my thinking too. I sort of took on the party idea, the club idea, the blacklight idea, and decided that I got invited to be in a show called Party After Party at SAIC. So I decided to make a dance floor, a painted dance floor with these Sintra panels that I've been making for a while. And I wasn't necessarily totally happy with how they were present in this space. They were still very much more in gallery mode. But what I was happy about then is going back to Sidecar in Hammond, Indiana, and working with the graffiti artist Ish Mohammed to make more of the panels. So the first batch I showed you where there were 16 panels, we ended up making 22 more panels and installing them in this domestic space. So we were sort of thinking about bringing the language of graffiti mixed with the language of abstraction from outside to inside. I was really interested in lining the interior of the entire space with these panels and really start to think about, okay, how do I create an experience for the viewer that is about entering the belly of the beast rather than always painting on the outside? Because I'd been thinking about this in terms of the performers sort of were always exclaimed about how beautiful the painting looked when they were inside the inflatables dancing, but nobody else could see that. So I sort of took on this idea of internal, external, and I also like the fact that urban was coming inside, bodies were coming inside, a reference to skate parks or ramps were sort of coming in, but it was in this very domestic, small-scaled space. Ish and I also worked on an inflatable sort of more mattressy pillow piece that we then stuffed like a sort of hidden monster up in the attic of that space. It was interesting working with Ish because I realized how formally trained I am, right? He pushed all my aesthetic buttons in terms of how I deal with painting and how I deal with image making and the idea of the tag has always been a real hard, I don't like symbolism necessarily in my work. I don't necessarily like seeing the hand so much or seeing a particular image painted on there. So he was interesting to work with in terms of me realizing how in some ways orderly I am, not always present. A few pieces here. I mean, I just want to show you this idea of using the whole animal or using the whole beast in my work. Of course, I'm known a lot for making really obnoxiously gargantuan work, but I also make very tiny miniature work too. My sort of mode of operation is to work at the extremes of scale. So if I can't make anything sort of in the middle ground, I have to make it either really giant or really tiny. Anyway, this is a piece that was sewn and stuffed from remnants of another bigger sculpture. And I like the theatrical quality of how it's photographed. I like that it's, again, got this sort of being-like existence and yet at a very small sort of handheld, it's probably this sort of scale, handheld scale. I also lately been making these little plaster sculptures by just pouring plaster into Ziploc bags and then squeezing them with my hand as they dry. So again, I like that there's this surprise in terms of people handling them to see them as heavy-weighted, hard-shelled, but look kind of soft thing. And again, that irreverent relationship to sculpture and that I just start spray painting on the plaster. So there's no idea of authenticity to materials whatsoever. This is a small wall installation from Lula Cafe this summer where I really was thinking about climbing walls. My son is a big climbing guy. And thinking about smaller scale groupings of things and sort of playful, comedic, sort of clown-like combinations of materials. So there's painted plaster, there's painted plywood shapes, there's stuffed fabric shapes too. And I called it scatter wall, and I think that sort of bodily reference to scatological sort of possibility in this piece was still sort of really important for me to embed some kind of body reference in there. at Oxbow this summer where I met Roz. I worked on these tiny clay sculpey doodles, basically. I think of them as doodles. But what was interesting to me, not necessarily the doodles themselves, but the fact that then the photographs of the doodles became really important, both in a way, such a way that you recognize the objects, and also in such a way that you do not recognize the objects. So that the digital becomes a really important tool for me to use as another branch of thinking about color, or thinking about form, or thinking about surface. So this is just a photograph of the sculpey really close up. So it becomes fuzzy and more diffuse, like the paint, the quality of paint that happens on the larger objects. So these are prints that are, I mean, obviously it's way big here, but 30 by 40 inches in scale. So it's fairly small for me, but expensive relative to the material I normally use. Crumpled paper pieces. And again, on the left, it's a documentary image of a crumpled paper piece that's spray painted. But then in the background, I messed digitally with, I just shot it quickly on the studio floor with my iPhone. And so then digitally, I'm able to bring it in and mess with the background and really, again, have that digital image version be another legitimate part of the project, right? I was also thinking about that. At the same time, I've been thinking recently about, okay, what if I did go back to a straight edge or a rectangle or the traditional modes of painting, but in a slightly closer way, but also mess with painting. I also got represented recently by a couple gallery spaces. So that sort of thinking about, oh shit, what do I show in a smaller space? You know, how do these people sell my work? You know, the sort of the practicalities of thinking commercially, which I really hate. That I'm very much a romantic. I really hate selling my work. I hate talking about my work too. But hey, I hate doing the sales pitch. I really loathsome all of it. But with these pieces, I've sort of wanted to. I've loved Ava Hesse's work for a long time, and I really wanted to make something that was mattress-like or pillow-like or stuffed, but that was also had a relationship to a straight edge. When I'm working architecturally within the larger pieces architecturally, I really love working with the straight edge of the wall or the top of the ceiling as a way to include an architectural or a clean or a minimal reference. So this is a sort of way for me to embed it in a smaller scale way without needing to plug stuff in. Another couple tests. Not sure how I feel about those yet, but hey. And then just this fall, it's been a busy fall, but I went to Portland and did this two-person show with this artist, Bahar Yurukoglu from Boston, who does this light video projection work. And we decided, so she was the one that illuminated the foreground here with the pink, and I really loved seeing these pieces, again, that I've shown a couple times now for a couple years, installed in a very different way, so I was surprised again. We also worked on a collaborative piece where I built this giant sort of iceberg kind of whale-like thing. And then she projected video and inserted plexiglass cut shapes into the piece. So I sewed a lot of pockets in the piece, which I had never done before. And I just really love the sort of crispness and the cleanliness and the fact that I could get color on the object without actually spending huge numbers of hours painting it. So I've been thinking a lot about working with Bahar again, and she's actually headed to a residency in the North Pole. She gets on a boat in 13 days. So she loved the collaboration, actually, and testing it. You're thinking of this thing as an iceberg because he actually is going to go and work on icebergs in the next couple weeks. So this is the Oxbow again with Roz. Just the idea of light becoming a really important part of the transformation of the objects. And the life of the objects, and the idea of the objects as event. So, and I should say at this point, this is My Little Pony piece again, but it's decapitated. I cut the head off at Oxbow this summer because it wasn't acting the way it needs to act in order to be a performance prop. It was too top heavy and too tall. So I had to basically chop its head off and do a... So this is its head. Yeah, and I repainted it a little bit, but this is the one of the most recent installations I put together, where this, I call this piece now Noggin. Is Noggin a word in America, or is that, I get confused these days. But the idea of the rolling head in the front of the space. And then these are more sort of much larger architectural, much more traditional painting shapes that I stretched on canvas, but I couldn't lay them against the wall. I couldn't hang them on the wall. I had to have them sit actively in the space as architectural walls. I was really interested too in what happens behind them, and also in backing them with and draping them, and thinking more theatrically about painting in space, right? So again, it's my inability to allow painting to just be painting. It has to be an object, right? But I really loved what happened with the glow of the lights in this space, with the lime green on one side and the orange, neon orange on the other. So, one last thing. I think this is the last slide, maybe. Photography, hugely important in my practice. I think there's so much discovery that happens when you're thinking about details of work. You're thinking about flattening and closing down space into an image, that becomes a really important part of my practice. And I'm a big, crazy, obsessive Instagrammer too, so Roz knows. Oh yeah, this is the last thing. This piece just opened up last night at Glass Curtain Gallery for the Division of Labor show that Roz talked about. And I think, so it's interesting to me now as somebody who's sort of a generation ahead of this new batch of Chicago artists who are becoming parents. And I think there's a much more politically active and savvy way that they are using this part of their lives in an explicit way that wasn't happening when I was first having kids. So I'm really sort of proud to be included in that kind of a show as it sort of bookends my sort of rant about allowing personality, allowing personal experience, and allowing character into your work in a way that you're not embarrassed by it. Minimalism has been detrimental in many ways, I think, to our ability to think of artists as humans and people, right? And that actually all of your characteristics, your personalities, drive your practice, whether you like it or not. And if you're interested in a more intellectual, more research-driven mode of operation, that is still a part of your character, part of your personality. You just it's a very different way of thinking that each of us have, and there's not one right way to do it. And I would sort of demand a mode of operation that is plural and multiplicitous across the art landscape somehow, rather than being a one-liner, right? And I think that's me. Does anybody have any questions? No? Thank you.